is very important. And the fact that they recognized it by looking out at oppressions to which they were not immediately party and dealing with them and then finding themselves accused. You know, you are that man. I think that kind of conversion doesn't come from outside or from authority either. That's a process from within. And I think it's very clear that in most of the relationships where women are marginated, mildly held in contempt, not taken seriously, discriminated against in terms of wage scales or promotion or whatever, and simply not considered in the planning of the future, I think in most of those situations the difficulty is that women are the accomplices, you know, that they have internalized that attitude to themselves, and that the process of changing the relationships is very subtle. There are three passages in the letters of the New Testament. The German scholars have called them the Haustafeln, that is the a kind of you might almost say a pecking order, a kind of a scale of arrangement of who reports to whom or who obeys whom. There are three passages like that in the writings of Peter and of Paul, which leave us with a puzzlement as to where they stood, where the apostolic preachers stood. When they say, for instance, the right order of things is, wives, be obedient to your husbands, and grown children, respect the authority of the paterfamilias, and slaves, subject yourselves to your masters. And one asks, in the context of the Christian gospel, how can they be saying this? Is it a betrayal? Is it simply a compromise with the situation as it is? The best explanation of it that I have heard, and which I really like, is that in the first place, the experience of the gospel was so liberating to the early Christians that they threw overboard all the conventions of their society, and that there were some drastic and unexpected results. That in a given city, if the women flung off their veils, that was fine, except that it happened to be the cultural signal that you were a prostitute. You know, that there are just other cultural implications involved in the moves that you make, and that a culture is a very complex interweaving of many signals and observances and a language and so on. So that you can't attack it head on by just throwing off everything that you think isn't right. And the theory is, therefore, that Peter and Paul are trying to unfold, given their human limitations, given that they don't see women's lib the way we would see it, right? Given that they don't see the issue of slavery as we would see it, and so on. But given their human limitations, that they're trying to unfold what they are convinced is another way of setting about it. That the other way, apparently, is the thesis that conversion happens from within outwards and not from the outside in. So that if in an oppressive situation you are able to free yourself of fear of your oppressive mentality and are able to relate to the other from a stance of freedom, that it is bound in the long run to change the structures. That's a hard saying. I think it's a very hard saying. It is much more obvious to say this particular behavior pattern is wrong, and therefore we should protest it and we should refuse to function within it. We should overthrow all the structures that reinforce it. That seems a more obvious way. In the theory of liberation, of consciousness raising, of Paulo Freire in Latin America, there is this interesting thesis that all of us move in our consciousness and in our behavior from what you might call submerged consciousness, where we simply photograph what is happening and accept it, which would be appropriate to the young child. The young child first has to find out what's going on in the world before it's going to be in a position to be critical about it. So we move from a position of submerged consciousness to a position of what you might call semi-consciousness. We are aware of the problems and the misfits in some respects, in some matters, but not across the board. And we move bit by bit out of that position of semi-consciousness into a position that you might call naive consciousness, in which there is a critical awareness, but it doesn't assess the whole reality of the situation. So that typically in the naive consciousness, if someone bullies you, you hit back in various ways. If you have a cruel landowner, the peasants go and burn his house down and kill him, and kill his family. This, you hope this doesn't often happen, but this is a sort of prototype of the naive consciousness response. But then you find that when you hit back at the bully, he bullies you more, because you put him on the defensive. You find that when you kill the padrone of the estate and all his family with him, his nephew inherits, and the nephew is already anxious when he comes because of what happened to his uncle, so he's more oppressive. You find that by the naive consciousness reactions, you don't actually solve it. And Paulo Freire's thesis is what we all have to keep doing, is moving towards truly critical consciousness, and truly critical consciousness will get beyond the tit-for-tat pattern of behavior, will get beyond trying to knock down the symptoms of the problem, will get beyond hating the person who oppresses you, or trying in turn to oppress that person, and will ask in great depth what the reality of the human relationships is, both in its interpersonal aspect, its spiritual aspect, you might say, and in its technical aspect, so that if it's on a large scale, what, for instance, makes for the economic oppression of this class? Or what makes for the systematic exclusion of women from the higher ranks into which they might be promoted? Looking at the technical analysis of that in a calm way, so as to discover what might be a way of transforming the whole structure, not just protesting the particular. So, yes, I think that the relationship of men to women in all manner of different human patterns of activity and experience is a critical aspect of human oppression, critical aspect of sin and sinful structures. I think that it can't be cured from the outside by legislation or by imposing patterns, though I think the legislation has to happen. Just as I said before, I think the papal guidance has to happen. I think it has to come from a transformation of consciousness and of life orientation and of motivation from within, so that the one-to-one relationships are gradually transformed and that the economic and political structures are studied very carefully to see how the pattern of exclusion is brought about.
I have a soft voice, so I guess I have more a comment than a question at this point, because I think you have at least partially answered it for me. When I listened to you speak, my heart did burn within me, and I heard it from the upside down, even mm-hmm. to what you were saying. I guess in listening to you, I could hear you saying that in order to respond, we have to have a conversion within our hearts. Mm-hmm. But even that conversion, I guess I believe, then spurs us on to action. And action, I guess I believe that compassion or action comes only in encounter.
Mm-hmm.
And that, like if we are truly to know the poor, the oppressed, the alienated in whatever mm-hmm. way, that it has to be in our personal contact, our personal encounter. And you only do that by taking the risk to be with another.
Mm-hmm.
And that's all.
Yes. Thank you for the comment. It's very much apropos. Thank you.
I think we want to save Dr. Hellwig's voice a little bit for this afternoon. So we thank you for coming. We remind you that this afternoon at 2 o'clock in this same auditorium, Dr. Hellwig will speak on the topic of sin and redemption in a contemporary focus. So thank you, and thank you, Dr. Hellwig.
I'm sure by now Monika Hellwig needs no introduction. Her topic this afternoon is Sin and Redemption in a Contemporary Focus. She'll obviously make the connections with what has preceded. I don't think my mic is working anymore, is it? Pardon. Slight technical problems. So Dr. Hellwig will make the necessary connection with the two lectures that have preceded this one. I would like to ask you simply that during the question period that follows, if at all possible, when you ask questions, Could you go to one of the two microphones that are standing in the aisles? If this inhibits you from asking a question, then don't go, okay? But if at all possible, so that everyone can hear. Dr. Hellwig.
Good afternoon. I'm happy to be with you again. Is the mic picking up? Can you hear? No. Can you hear now?
No.
It's dead. Is it different yet? No. How about this? If it should fade out again, please wave from the back so that I will know that you're not hearing anymore. I will try to do the same as I did this morning, that is to say, stop at about 5 minutes of three so that those who have a 3:05 class can leave, but then I will stay for as long as you have questions, those of you who want to stay afterwards and are able to. What I said in the earlier lectures will have led you, I think, to some reflection on the question of what we really mean by sin and redemption. Father Hogan asked me the question, doesn't this begin to sound like secular humanism? And I said to him, yes, and so did Jesus sound like secular humanism, and he was accused of that. But there comes a time when we really do have to ask the question, what do we mean by sin, and therefore what is redemption? You probably know that the various liberation movements that have happened in the world of our time have tried to latch on to the traditional theology of redemption, and that there has been a certain defensiveness on the part of both theologians and church hierarchy, because there was a fear that we were not taking sin and the need of spiritual redemption seriously anymore. In response to that, one of the liberation theologians, whose name is Gustavo Gutierrez, made the reply, well, we see that there are many levels of liberation or freedom, that there is the liberation, the psychological liberation of people to be themselves, to be what they really are without fear or embarrassment or shame. There is the liberation from economic want and deprivation. There's the liberation from oppression by foreign powers, national liberation. And there is a kind of ongoing liberation in history from some of the burdens that oppress us, and that liberation goes on by way of technology. And beyond that, said Gustavo Gutierrez, is truly liberation from sin, from alienation from God. But, he said, although these are different, they are so intimately interconnected that we better not try to talk about sin and redemption in detachment from all the kinds of unfreedom, oppression, and suffering that people really experience in their lives. And this is important because for many people today, as you're probably more than well aware, the notion of sin is rather receding into the background. And if we don't have a clear sense of what sin is, there is no need for redemption. Redemption is the other side of the coin, or the negation, if you like, of sin. That sends us back to some very basic reflections in our own origins, or upon our own origins. First of all, as you and I were taught, I would suppose, certainly as I was taught in catechism classes, there was a tendency to understand sin in relation to the sacrament of reconciliation, if you were raised Catholic. There is a certain problem in that, and it's a problem that people who were raised in Protestant communions tended to avoid. Not always, but they tended to. The problem about learning to recognize sin in relation to the sacrament of reconciliation as we have latterly practiced it in an individual, private confession of sins is that you will be pushed, or you yourself might be anxious to come quickly to the point of listing specific sins so that you know how to go through the sacramental routine. Therefore, the focus will tend to be on lists of transgressions or lists of disobeying rules. The biblical focus is not like that. If we look back at the biblical accounts of sin, several things are very clear. That sin is recognized as a pervasive condition of life before it's recognized as specific actions. Sin is recognized as something that we suffer from before it's recognized as something that we perpetrate. Sin is diagnosed, so to speak, in terms of human suffering. And perhaps the starkest way that that emerges is in the person of Jesus himself. Jesus was to his contemporaries a puzzlement, a challenge, and often a scandal. And in particular, he was a scandal because of the company he kept and the judgments he made. I promised in an earlier lecture that I would develop that further. The people of his own time, the devout, the good, were alarmed because Jesus didn't seem to make the proper distinctions between the good people and the bad people. The respectable people and the disreputable people, the pious and the sinners. He seemed to consort with the tax gatherers, who were known as a shady crowd of people because they contracted with the Romans to get in a certain amount of duty, a certain amount of customs money, or a certain amount of poll tax. And they contracted on a basis that left them free to extort much more out of the ordinary people. They were, in a sense, in many ways, oppressing and betraying their own people. Jesus consorted with them. He consorted with women who earned their living as prostitutes. He consorted with people who were known to be not careful observers of the law. And he tolerated it that his followers and his close associates were somewhat careless in their observance of the law. Jesus was challenged on that many times. And in response to that challenge, we are given one wonderful story that he told. And it's the story of the prodigal son. And in that story, he really directs his listeners back to what ought to have been their own Jewish understanding of sin and repentance. And the story has to do with a son who leaves home having demanded disposal of his future share of the property. You have to know that in the time of Jesus, this was not an uncommon pattern for younger sons to migrate from the farms into the cities, and that at the time of Jesus, the legal situation was quite clear, that this was a flaunting of the traditional Jewish law by which the property, the land, should stay in the hands of the larger families, the extended families to whom it had been allotted, and by which you were not permitted to alienate your future share in the property. It was impossible to alienate the present share in the property before the father died. But what the younger sons were doing was playing, so to speak, in the futures market. And they were getting someone to give them a pittance in ready cash in exchange for future access to the land when the father died. It was against the law, but you have to remember, of course, that this was the law of Moses, and therefore there wasn't a sharp distinction between morality and civic law. It was therefore a rebellion against the tradition, against the religious observances, and so on. The story makes more sense in that context, that the younger son is saying, I don't care about the tradition, the family home, what has been invested in this before my time. I would choose to substitute for it something very trivial, something very frivolous, something immediate, cash in hand. And the story, of course, has the son leaving home and getting into deeper and deeper distress and recognizing his alienation in the bitterness of his suffering, recognizing his alienation in his loneliness, his hunger, his degradation, and simply his homesickness, and saying to himself, it's time I went back. The repentance comes out of the depth of his suffering, the recognition that he's not at home, the recognition that he needs to get back comes out of the experience of his suffering. And the story has a very interesting pattern of return, because the boy comes back ready to make a confession, ready to itemize his transgressions, why he knows he's in disgrace. And the father, who has gone a long way to meet him, is not interested in the confession. The father is not interested in what he's done while he's away. He's only interested in the question of whether the boy is on the way back, whether he's returning. There is a further part to the story, of course, and the further part is most clearly put there in the context in which the whole story is told, namely the bewilderment of the good people at the time of Jesus over the fact that he can be so cavalier about the difference between the devout and the sinful, the respectable, the good people, and the utterly disreputable, who have transgressed in spectacular ways. The second part of the story is that in the same household is another son who apparently is miles and miles away from the father while living right beside him on the farm, who apparently is very deeply alienated, is turned resolutely in the other direction with his face turned away from the father, but who doesn't know it. And the father approaches him with exactly the same offer, really, that he made to the other son. He says, but I'm here, everything I have is yours. Come and celebrate with us. And we're told that that older son had extraordinary difficulty. We're not really told whether he went in or he didn't go in. But he's bitter. He's very bitter because he feels that in his case, there is no need for a conversion, that he is already there. The interesting thing is that, of course, in the Greek in which we have the New Testament, when they're talking about repentance, they're talking about metanoia, which means changing one's mind, one's vision, one's outlook, one's perception, seeing things anew. But in the Hebrew, a much more physical verb is used, lashuv, to turn around, to turn on your heel and go back where you came from, to change your direction, to retrace your steps. And the story that Jesus tells is really a story that just spells out what Jews should in any case have understood about sin. Namely, that sin is a question of being turned in the wrong direction, of having the wrong focus, of having things out of focus, of having things out of harmony, and that conversion is not really a matter of ticking off activities of which you repent, specific actions for which you have to say you're sorry, and for which perhaps you have to do penance, but that conversion is rather a matter of just literally that, turning around. In the Latin, we kept it, conversion, turning around. Again, in the tradition of the Talmudic scholars in Israel, there is a very simple version of the same story, and it goes just like this. There was a father whose son went away from him, and the father said, "Come back." And the son said, "I can't get back. I can't get back." And the father said, "Come as far as you can. I'll be there to meet you." That's the whole story. But this is the classic story of conversion. And of course, any of us who are parents know what that story is about. If our small son were to phone and say, "I'm quite lost, I don't know where I am, I can't get home," the obvious answer that any of us would give is not, "Now, what did you do? How did you manage to get there? What have you been up to?" That's not the answer we'd give. The answer we'd give would be quite simply, "I will come and get you. Try and describe to me calmly where you are. What does it look like? Is there a store near there? Is there a street sign? Tell me where you are, and I will come and get you." The story of the prodigal son seems to be a story that invites us to reflect on human family relationships and ask ourselves what, in God's eyes, must be the whole question of sin and repentance, and invites us to understand that we're not really concerned with the need to itemize evil deeds. We are concerned to grapple with the consequences of evil deeds, to grapple with a whole set of values, expectations, relationships, which don't quite fit together, which aren't quite authentic, which are self-defeating, which are destructive, to grapple with that, knowing the need to turn around and take the project back. Israel, of course, had a story that already enshrined that whole understanding. It's a story that doesn't appear in the canonical scriptures, but which is obviously assumed by the canonical scriptures, and which we are all with which we are all familiar from our catechetical training. It's the story of Lucifer. As a backdrop to the story of the temptation in the garden, of course, you need to know the prior story about Lucifer. You need to know this large projection of the human situation onto a larger canvas in which you are invited to imagine a great primordial creation in which the issues are very clearly this. Do these splendid creatures, these splendid creations, accept their creaturehood, accept their dependence, accept their debt of gratitude for their existence, or do they assert themselves, turning, as it were, away from the Father's house to make a life of their own? And the Lucifer story, you remember, is captioned really in the response of the Great Spirit, "I will not serve." You may have seen old stained glass windows are illuminations in books in which this is the banner, the slogan of Lucifer. Non serviam, I will not serve. I will not bend my being to be for another. I will not acknowledge dependence. Now it's interesting that Israel should have grasped the fundamental issue of sin and redemption in those terms, in terms of dependence, in terms of acknowledging dependence, in terms of acknowledging that to be as a creature is to be for another, to find one's fulfillment in the other. In the Lucifer story, we are given the beginnings of a whole sequence that explains where we are now. And the sequence suggests that at the very source of human history, in the very process of the creation of human becoming, there is the gift of integrity, of clear vision, of community, of fearlessness, in a sense, the gift of immortality, of deathlessness, at the very source of our being created. But at the same time, that all of the integrity of human being and becoming, the pattern of its fitting together, its harmony, its focus, its purposefulness, is dependent on an acknowledgement of a gratitude, an acknowledgement of creaturehood, an acknowledgement of situated freedom. And by that I mean that our experience of being human is certainly an experience of freedom, an experience that we co-create ourselves, that we are not predetermined, that we fashion ourselves, and yet that we fashion ourselves and fashion our world in a situation not of our making, in a context that is given, in a life that is gift, undeserved gift. And Israel apparently in its stories grasps this as the rock bottom issue of sin and redemption, of what is holiness and what is destruction, what is damnation. That the issue is, will you accept your freedom, the good gift of your life, the paradise of pleasures, which is symbolic, the harmony and the gift of life, will you accept it as gift? Will you accept it in creaturely dependence? Will you accept it as a freedom that is limited, a freedom that is situated? And the interesting form of the temptation with which the protagonists in the story are confronted, the interesting form of that temptation is, wouldn't you like to be like God in independence from God? Wouldn't you like, in other words, to take your inheritance, cash it in, and set up life on your own? Create your own... Have I faded off? Am I on again? Good. Wouldn't you like to create your own world in your own image and likeness, your own way? And there's an extraordinary play on imagery and ideas there, because you'll recall that in the paradise story, in the creation story, they are made in the image and likeness of God. And that the temptation is, wouldn't you like to be like God? But it's the question of the terms. In the image and likeness of God, in dependence, in interdependence, in community, and in acceptance of limitation, or on terms of independence, of self-centeredness, and of a focus that would never be adequate because it's a focus that won't sustain the weight that is being thrown at it. The story of sin and the story of redemption are really the same story for us today, because of course the story of Adam, person, and the story of Hava, interpreted as mother of the living, community, the community that reaches out the fruit of temptation to the person. That story isn't just a story about some people very long ago that were different from ourselves. That's the story of our everyday existence. The story of our existence is that the mother of our life, the community that mothers us, the community that brings us into existence, holds out to us the fruit of temptation. What kind of temptation? A whole set of values which represent the effect of cumulative destructive deeds. A whole set of values slightly skewed, somewhat distorted, not quite matching together. Values like this. You are told as you grow up that you should be a nice person, friendly and good to everybody, but at the same time you are being told insidiously, persistently, to compete as though you were crazy to get to the top, to get ahead, to get the best position for yourself, the best job, the best alliances, the best home, the best facilities. You're taught that you have to get ahead of other people or you won't survive. Those two things don't fit together. They don't fit together. But you're told those so subtly that you don't recognize they don't fit together. You are told that it's important to build community and to be a good citizen and so on. But at the same time, you're told there are classes of people that aren't really as good as you and that it'll be very important to hold them down where they are, keep them out of it. You're told on the one hand that it's a society in which we should all behave democratically. Everyone should have a share in determining the future and so on. But at the same time, we are conditioned to seeking certain privileges, certain advantages, and to seeking our security in them. We are certainly told that we ought to be charitable and we ought to be just and so on. But at the same time, we are taught to articulate into a profit system, into a pattern of classes of interest. We are taught to make sure to promote our own nation beyond other nations. On the one hand, it's very important to maintain peace. On the other hand, yes, but peace where we have an edge on the others so that we can control it, that we can be a little ahead of them. I don't need to give lots of examples of it. In 1001 ways, we are taught a way of containing the violence that is always ready to erupt in human society. We are taught a pattern of law, a pattern of order, a pattern of respectability, which is really like a set of rules to restrain or hold down to an acceptable level the violence that people can do to one another, to give them acceptable channels. I think what the biblical doctrine of sin and redemption have to say to us is, in the beginning it wasn't so. In the beginning it isn't so. In the creative impulse of God out of which we spring, it isn't so. In that creative impulse, we are made to respond to God creating us, to attend to God, to be open to God, largely by being open to community with one another, largely by finding our common harmony and life in the world together without exclusions. In fact, the biblical stories of sin are a sequence of stories in which one evil deed or the consequences of one evil deed keeps leading to a problem in which other evil deeds are committed. There is a kind of history of disintegration alongside of a history of hope and reconstruction. In the person of Jesus, we discover a new dimension to that, namely that given a history of distorted judgments, given a history of false values, it is first of all extremely difficult for us to see straight. Secondly, it's extremely difficult for us to arrive at sufficient detachment to act upon what we see. And thirdly, even were we able to see straight and to act upon what we see, that the consequences are necessarily going to involve elements of tragedy, because we recognize slowly a structure of the world in which what we have learned to trust turns out to be untrustworthy. That's a hard saying. That's a hard message. The vision that the gospel puts in front of us, of course, is the somewhat stylized life of Jesus, in which we are presented in the story of the public life with a process of discernment. Jesus preaches the coming of the reign of God, the simplicity of it, the fact that the rule of God that sets all things right into proper perspective, into proper harmony, that the rule of God is not to be sought far away, but among us, within us, in our hearts. That to seize it is very simple. That the gift at all times is held out, but in which Jesus himself soon learns that it doesn't look as simple to other people as it looks to him. In the intertestamental period, there was a teaching about the reign of God and the coming of the reign of God, which went largely by bold apocalyptic imagery. There were scenes in nature, in the universe, depicted where the reign of God would come really like lightning flashing from east to west, where the firmament would be, the heavenly bodies would be transformed, and so on. And if in the intertestamental period a Jew would pursue the scribes and say, but what does it mean? He would be given further images or further stories. He would never be given a proper explanation, what we would think of as a proper explanation. And the answer would be, no one can really tell you what it's like other than give these imaginary pictures. But if you want to know what it's like, live now with a passion, with the totality of your being. as though God reigned and nobody else did, and just take the consequences. Live reckless of the consequences, as though God reigned now. Whatever you understand, whatever you see of the way God calls people to live together, the way God calls you to live, do it, and you'll keep seeing more and more between the lines of the law. And eventually, you will get a clarity of vision that you will see the reign of God coming as from within. You will have a sense and experience of how the reign of God is coming. I think the Gospels are presenting us Jesus as the person who does that. That he lives with a clarity of vision because he lives with that kind of totality of acceptance of the Father's will that is reckless of the consequences. That no matter what the consequences are going to be, this is the way he responds to it and is going to see it. There is a story behind that, a Hebrew story behind that. You know the story that we have in the canonical scriptures about Moses going up into the mountain and coming down the first time, and they're dancing around the golden calf, and he breaks the tablets, and then eventually he goes back and there's another set of tablets. There is a Midrashic story behind that which gives a lot of insight. They say the first time Moses came down, Moses, being a great mystic and contemplative, had absolutely nothing on the tablets. They were totally blank because the law of God was so simple. There wasn't anything you could say. It was so simple and so obvious, just so self-evident. And when Moses sees them dancing around the golden calf, he knows, he's deeply convinced they can never read what's written on blank tablets, and so he smashes them. In the Midrashic story, God has a little heart-to-heart with Moses and says, since you think yourself so clever that you know what they can read and what they can't read, you make up your own jolly old commandments. I've had it with you. You go and you just draft your commandments. And in the Midrashic story, Moses then goes painfully and he writes out his version of what it should be. The point of that Midrashic story is that the law is never anything more than a pedagogue. That the law can never be more than a way of learning when you're not mature enough to see it for yourself. That the law is a kind of a training. You remember Paul refers to it as that. The law is a pedagogue. But you remember that Paul also says, but you know, a really better law, a better teacher would be Jesus himself. You get there faster. You focus faster on the real issue if you look at Jesus himself, instead of looking at the 613 commandments. Did you know there were 613? We usually think there are 10. But as Jews spelt them out, including the ritual law, they were 613. But even in Israel, there was always the conviction, sin isn't really the transgression of these particular commands. Paul says that too. He says, you know, the whole point of the law was just to show you where sin is. It's just to convict you of your sin, to show you where you're out of focus. But then you're stuck. That's as far as you can go with the law. The rabbis of the Hebrew tradition had somewhat the same insights, because they, even before the time of Jesus, they had a tradition that said, well, Moses gave us 613 commandments, but actually if you read this prophet or that prophet and listen to what is being said, you could really reduce it to about 17. Or you could look at such and such a text or such and such a teacher. You might reduce it to about 9. Or you could even take this text and you could see the whole thing in 3 commandments, and so on. And the striving among the teachers of Israel was indeed to see the principle of coherence behind those commandments so as to show that sin and therefore redemption are not a matter of whether you transgress all these particular prescriptions and whether you find your way back into the observance of them all, but whether you can read between the lines what Moses had on the blank tablets after God gave them to him and before Moses had to write his own version of it. Whether you can follow the actual prescriptions of the law with devotion, study the law with your life so that it all becomes lots clearer and simpler and you begin to see the issues. It's in that context, I think, that we might look at that interesting encounter that Jesus had, which is variously told, maybe it was several encounters, variously told about a rich young man or a doctor of the law. You know the story, I mean? One way or another, Jesus had a confrontation with someone who was very devout and recognized Jesus as a teacher of exceptional insight and said, "Tell me what is really the heart of it." Now, someone who comes knowing the law of Israel and asks that question would certainly already know that there is this effort to reduce it all to its simplest dimensions, to its most global categories, its most immediate lifestyle and attitude. And in that context, you remember, Jesus throws him back on his own resources and says, "But you can do that for yourself because you know the commandments, and we've been told to study the commandments not just with our heads but with our hearts and with our whole lives and to come to the inner sense of them." And the young man says, "Yes, I know the commandments. I really have been keeping them. But, well, where does it lead?" And in you remember that the story in one version really turns it back to him and says, "Well, haven't you figured that out for yourself?" And he gives the answer, "Yes, I guess I have figured it out for myself. But it all boils down to this: to seek God with a passion, to get your values in an order, in a hierarchy in which they fit, to arrange the desires or the wants, the strivings of your life, so that God is all in all, that God overarches all other things and everything is made relative to doing the will of God, to tuning in to God. And then I have it figured that really if you take the whole thing seriously, the other half of it is to love your neighbor." And Jesus endorses that reading and says, "Yes, that's exactly what it leads to." But the interesting wrinkle is that one version of the story gives us then in sequence the parable of the Good Samaritan. One version of the story says the man wanted to justify himself and he wanted to say, "But look, it sounds so simple when I'm talking to you and it isn't a bit simple in the way I live out my life. I simply know that the minute you're not there and I'm not talking to you, it's all very, very much more complicated than that. And I feel vaguely cheated by the way you're directing me to this very simple, obvious answer. And then life turns out not to be like that." You remember that the context of the Good Samaritan then is the question, well, who is my neighbor? What is the human, or if you like, the horizontal dimension of sin and conversion? And that I'm rushing a little now so that I'll finish by 5:03. And that the issue is exclusion. Whether you exclude people who are not of your set or are not important or are in a rival group, and also whether you exclude human needs because professionally you are committed to another line of obligations, whether you exclude human need on the basis of your religious